Aunty Toothache by Hans Christian Andersen, narrated by Alex Lehman. Where did we get this story? Would you like to know? We got it from the basket that the waste paper's thrown into. Many a good and rare book has been taken to the delicatessen store and the grocer's not to be read, but to be used as wrapping paper for starch and coffee, beans, for salted herring, butter and cheese. Used writing paper has also been found suitable. Frequently one throws into the waste paper basket what ought not to go there. I know a grocer's assistant, the son of a delicatessen store owner. He's worked his way up from serving in the cellar to serving in the front shop. He's a well-read person, his reading consisting of the printed and written matter to be found on the paper used for wrapping. He has an interesting collection, consisting of several important official documents from the waste paper baskets of busy and absent-minded officials, a few confidential letters from one lady friend to another, reports of scandal which were to go no further, not to be mentioned by a soul. He is a living salvage institution for more than a little of our literature, and his collection covers a wide field. He has the run of his parents' shop and that of his present master, and has there saved many a book, or leaves a book, well worth reading twice. He has shown me his collection of printed and written matter from the waste paper basket, the most valued items of which have come from the delicatessen store. A couple of leaves from a large composition book lay among the collection. The unusually clear and neat handwriting attracted my attention at once. This was written by the student, he said, the student who lived opposite here and died about a month ago. He suffered terribly from toothache, as one can see. It is quite amusing to read. This is only a small part of what he wrote. There was a whole book and more besides. My parents gave the student's landlady half a pound of green soap for it. This is what I've been able to save of it. I borrowed it, I read it, and now I tell it. The title was Aunty Toothache, Chapter 1. Aunty gave me sweets when I was little. My teeth could stand it then. It didn't hurt them. Now I'm older, I'm a student, and still she goes on spoiling me with sweets. She says I'm a poet. I have something of the poet in me, but not enough. Often when I go walking along the city streets, it seems to me as if I am walking in a big library. The houses are the bookshelves, and every floor is a shelf with books. There stands a story of everyday life. Next to it is a good old comedy, and there are works of all scientific branches, bad literature, and good reading. I can dream and philosophize among all this literature. There is something of a poet in me, but not enough. No doubt many people have just as much of it in them as I, though they do not carry a sign or a necktie with the word poet on it. They and I have been given a divine gift, a blessing great enough to satisfy oneself, but altogether too little to be portioned out again to others. It comes like a ray of sunlight and fills one's soul and thoughts. It comes like the fragrance of a flower, like a melody that one knows and yet cannot remember from where. The other evening I sat in my room and felt an urge to read, but I had no book, no paper. Just then a leaf, fresh and green, fell from the lime tree, and the breeze carried it in through the window to me. I examined the many veins in it. A little insect was crawling across them, as if it were making a thorough study of the leaf. This made me think of man's wisdom. We also crawl about on a leaf. Our knowledge is limited to that only, and yet we unhesitatingly deliver a lecture on the whole big tree, the root, the trunk, and the crown, the great tree comprised of God, the world, and immortality, and of all this we know only a little leaf. As I was sitting there, I received a visit from Aunt Mille. I showed her the leaf with the insect and told her of my thoughts in connection with these, and her eyes lit up. "You are a poet," she said, "perhaps the greatest we have. If I should live to see this, I would go to my grave gladly. Ever since the brewer Rasmussen's funeral, you have amazed me with your powerful imagination." So said Aunty Mille, and then she kissed me. Who was Aunty Mille, and who was Rasmussen the brewer? Chapter 2. We children always called our mother's aunt Auntie. We had no other name for her. She gave us jam and sweets, although they were very injurious to our teeth. But the dear children were her weakness, she said. It was cruel to deny them a few sweets when they were so fond of them, and that's why we loved Auntie so much. She was an old maid. As far back as I can remember, she was always old. Her age never seemed to change. In earlier years, she had suffered a great deal from toothache, and she always spoke about it. and so it happened that her friend, the brewer Rasmussen, who has a great wit, called her Aunty Toothache. He had retired from the brewing business some years before and was then living on the interest of his money. He frequently visited Aunty. He was older than she. He had no teeth at all, only a few black stumps. When a child, he had eaten way too much sugar, he told us children, and that's how he came to look as he did. Aunty could surely never have eaten sugar in her childhood, for she had the most beautiful white teeth. She took great care of them, and she did not sleep with them at night, said Rasmussen the brewer. We children knew this was said in malice, but Aunty said he did not mean anything by it. One morning at the breakfast table, she told us of a terrible dream she had had during the night in which one of her teeth had fallen out. That means, she said, that I shall lose a true friend. Was it a false tooth? Asked the brewer with a chuckle. If so, it can only mean that you will lose a false friend. You are an insolent old man, said Aunty, angrier than I had seen her before or ever have since. She later told us that her old friend had only been teasing her. He was the finest man on earth, and when he died he would become one of God's little angels in heaven. I thought a good deal of this transformation, and wondered if I would be able to recognize him in this new character. When Aunty and he had been young, he had proposed to her. She had settled down to think it over, had thought too long, and had become an old maid, but always remained his true friend. And then Brewer Rasmussen died. He was taken to his grave in the most expensive hearse and was followed by a great number of folks, including people with orders and in uniform. Aunty stood dressed in mourning by the window together with all of us children, except our little brother, whom the stork had brought a week before. When the hearse and the procession had passed and the street was empty, Aunty wanted to go away from the window, but I didn't want to. I was waiting for the angel, Rasmussen the brewer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.